Well, to me, I'm on the committee to help make the affordable care. And I gotta tell you, that nobody on that committee, Republican, Democrat, whatever, ever considered the best plan in one second that states would reject an expansion of Medicaid, which was free, which did not cost them a nickel, and which in South Carolina, as I recall, would have resulted in the creation of tens of thousands of jobs.
Well, we didn't go around to Texas. It's been an ideological mistake. Only an example. The Democratic governor, Glasgow, he signed the bill that day, and 300,000 came on Medicaid. But Virginia around Texas, they are rejecting federal money. I'm from South Carolina, and you folks say from Vermont. Federal government grants, Medicaid, you can get it, and I can. Am I the unprotected on that state's rights of available federal rights?
It's unbelievable. I mean, it really is unbelievable. And the answer is, I mean, how we deal with that, and how we tell South Carolina that the African Americans and the whites and the Latinos are entitled to health care, especially since the government passed the bill to provide that health care, you know that I would go further and fight for Medicare for all legislation which guarantees health care to all people as a right.
This week, Dr. Young brought the vote on the leaders of the Comprehensive Health Care Act that we should give a special reference to Dr. Wayne Young.
Well, I didn't know that.
Dr.
Wayne Young, I didn't know that he passed away. I know for a long time. What a wonderful man.
Wonderful man.
And he is one of the leaders in this country in fighting for what we call Medicare for All single payer program. I'm sorry to hear that he passed away.
Brandon, what happens to him? Where does this deal come down? We freed the bankers, locked up the children, shipped the jobs out, cut the football girlfriend, ran into the long debt. That's the mess we need here. That talk freed the bankers, locked up the children with three strikes, and then shipped out the jobs. So right there, Chicago, drunk guns in, drugs in, job out, and low investment. We will need a president who can address that crisis.
Well, we need a president who can address the problem. Well, what we also need in this country is a political revolution. And that's what I was saying. All over this country is a simple truth, and it's not a pleasant truth. If I were elected president tomorrow, do you think that I or you or anybody here could take on Wall Street and corporate America and the large campaign donors all by ourselves? The answer is no. These people have so much power. They have an endless supply of money. They buy and sell politicians. You threaten them to shut down the air and move to China. The only way we beat them, and that's what Rainbow Coalition is about, that's what I call the political revolution, is bringing millions of people together around a progressive agenda. And there's nothing you have ever said, or I have ever said, that is particularly radical. Every major country on earth guarantees health care to all people. Why can't we? Why does this country have more wealth and income inequality than any other major country on earth? Why do we have the highest rate of childhood poverty amongst any major country on earth? Why do we give tax breaks to billionaires and then say 50 schools in Chicago being shut down for lack of funding? Does that make sense to anybody? We're the only country on earth, rich or poor, almost the only, that doesn't guarantee paid family and medical leave. So a woman has a baby, she has to go back to work a week or two in order to earn enough money to take care of her family. Every other country guarantees that woman months of time off to take care of her newborn baby. In other words, our priority. people on top who have incredible wealth in the last 30 years has been a major transfer of wealth from the middle class to the top 1/10 of 1%. And what this campaign is about is ending all of that, rebuilding working families in this country. And
Hillary is president of this country. As we see to the modern life happening in Yellowstone Park, that's quite a bit. When the U.S. Olympic team plays China in China, we know the plan about .com because the plan for this event rules public goals to their reference was transparent. So we globalize capital, we do not globalize human rights and worker rights and children rights and environments. What can we do to globalize human and worker rights and trade and trade policy?
What you say is that the United States is not going to have free trade agreements in countries where workers can't form unions, where there is child labor, where there is massive environmental degradation. It is unfair for American workers to be competing against people who are earning starvation wages. And one of the things that I have done from day one in Congress, where my views are very different from Secretary Clinton's, I have opposed all of these disastrous trade agreements which have ended up costing this country millions of decent paid jobs and pushing us into a race to the bottom. Now try to understand that today workers in the automobile industry who get a new job are in some cases earning half the wages that the older workers earn. We're moving in the wrong direction. Instead of wages going up, they're going down. And that has to do with race to the bottom and employers saying, if you don't take a wage cut, we're going to move to China. We're going to move to Mexico, and that is a trade policy that has got to be changed.
The fact that the very end is that we share 2,000 miles of border with Mexico. They are almost organic neighbor. We will help them be neighbors in Mexico. We are working on training Mexico community. And this is just the door to Latin America. And 2/3 of this hemisphere is Latin America, 1/3 English speaking America. And seemingly we're insensitive to turning Mexicans into enemies and turning our backs on refugees and those who are Christian. Jesus was a refugee. It's hard to raise a refugee on Sunday and a lot of refugees out on Monday morning, it seems to me. And then the target Muslims. That's something dangerous and toxic going on in our country today. I have great anxiety about what we saw last night and how that could metastasize the spread.
Well, what Trump is doing is incredibly dangerous at so many levels. I mean, how do you have a president of the United States who insults Latin America and all Mexican names? How do you have a president that wants to be president insulting Muslims, one of the largest religions in the world?
And there are more Muslims than there are Christians, and more Muslims than there are Americans. And so the attack then in that sense puts America in isolation.
Right, of course it does. But here's the guy who is also attacking women. And I want everybody here, sometimes we forget this. You remember who was one of the leaders of the so-called Bertha movement?
Yes.
All right, it was Donald Trump. And what was that about? That was a very dangerous effort to delegitimize the President of the United States to say, well, he really is not the President. Because he's not an American citizen. How dangerous is that to try to undermine in that deep way? You can disagree with the model, that's fine. But don't delegitimize his presidency. I can make this point, this is an interesting point. My father was born in Poland. President Obama's father was born in Kenya. Guess what? Nobody has That reason is they have seen the economy slip away from them. They have seen their jobs go to China. They are working in some cases longer hours, low wages. They're worried about their kids. But instead of looking at the cause of their problems, what they're doing is scapegoating, which has gone on forever. That's what the adultery is about. To take people's fear and anger and turn them against minorities.
You know, some of them are angry. I think some of them are angry at Abraham Lincoln. Really, a lot of them are angry at Abraham Lincoln and the Emancipation Proclamation. Those who were Jefferson Davis Democrats in 1965 became Goldwater Reagan Republicans. So they've really just been Republicans for the last 51 years. So they're angry at Dr. King and the Kennedys as being transformers. But they're also angry at the loss of their jobs. So they're kind of angry at three levels. But the scapegoating is easy, simple, and very, very dangerous.
You know, in the 1950s, the lowest paid white workers in America, and they were really paid very low, were in Mississippi. They were paid nothing. And you know how the system got away with that? Because it was scapegoating. They said, look, you're not making any money. You can't afford food. You can't afford housing. You can't afford health care. You can't afford sending your kid to college because you're making nothing. But you know what you got? You can drink and then work out. And the black guy can't.
Those government agencies lie to the most of their own.